You guys know where we're going to begin with. Where are we going in the scriptures? Where? Isaiah 60. Yes, that's where we're going to go. Isaiah chapter number 60. I want you to get this in your heart. I've said this entire time, and I feel like this is the will of the Lord for us as a church family, is to get this in our heart and let the word of God speak to us from Isaiah chapter 60, 1 through 5. It's so profound to me. It's so profound of what God is doing in my own heart. And I have to believe that if God is doing something in my heart as your pastor and leader, I feel like that's what he's wanting to do in all of our hearts. I believe that's together. I believe those things, anything always flows through the channel of the way the Lord does things. It's like when he blessed and multiplied the food as the disciples brought him what he had and then they distributed. And it was for the betterment. It was for the food of the entire crowd. And I believe that same situation is so that if the Lord begins to bring something to bear upon myself, and first off, I've got to differentiate, Lord, is that for me, my family, and that only, or is that for myself and the entire church? And here's what I've come to find out, too, that a lot of times the Lord kind of flows both of those a little bit together. I mean, in other words, the blessing that goes to my family is also a blessing that's got to come to the church. I find that the Lord does that a lot together. God doesn't have me live such a compartmentalized life. In fact, I think a real compartmentalized life, being one way at church and a different way at home, can be detrimental to your walk with God. I believe that I understand that there are compartmental things that happen in life, and people don't need to know all your problems and difficulties and that sort of thing. I get that. I recognize that some things, it's not everybody's information to have. But at the same time, that's not permission to live compartmentalized in a way that is unhealthy. So, I just believe that where the Lord is. And so Isaiah 60 is very much a part of the fabric of my being, and I'm praying. I want you to know this. You would think after a year of doing Isaiah 61 and 2 that I would have finished exhausting every prayer that I could potentially pray that deals with that two passages of Scripture. But I'm telling you, I have not. The Lord continues to deepen my heart for Isaiah 61 and 2, and now he's extended for us this year on up to verse number 5. And I would love for you that at times at home, would you just pray through Isaiah chapter 61 through 5. Lord, what does this mean for me? You've put this on pastor's heart. You've been giving it to us now for a year. Lord, what does this mean for me? What does it mean for my family? What does it mean for my life? How am I supposed to digest this? What am I supposed to get out of this? What is it that you're trying to show me? What are you trying to help me to understand? Isaiah 61 through 5. That's where we're going to read, and then we're going to go to Isaiah 58. So here we go. The Bible says, "Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people, but the Lord will arise over you. His glory will be seen upon you. The Gentiles shall come to your light, and the kings to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes all around and see. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from afar, and your daughters shall be nursed by your side. Then you shall become radiant, and your heart will swell with joy, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you. The wealth of the Gentiles shall come to you." I've been really trying to digest, God, what does it really mean to arise and shine? As you guys know, and we've been really going through this, I recognize that arise means maybe to change your posture. In other words, God, when God's saying to people, arise, shine, I tend to think, I've got a coffee cup at my house that says rise and shine. And I use that coffee cup now. That's what I'm using right now. I kind of go through coffee cups quite, I don't know, one gets piled up about that thick with coffee lining on it, you know. Because my grandpa taught me, don't wash your coffee cup, right? You're not, like, you need hair and everything growing on the side of that so you can have the taste of coffee. Even if you just put water in it, you just have good coffee after that, after a while. Just heat up the water and you got good coffee, because the stuff on the side make coffee. That's pretty nasty, isn't that? Probably shouldn't have told that. Now you know why COVID wasn't that bad for me. No, I'm just kidding. It says arise, shine, and so arise and shine. And I used to have this little alarm on my phone that would start off playing, "Wake up, sleepyhead, haul your hiney out to bed." I think of arise as it's time to get up. It's time to wake up. It's time to shift your posture from laying down in a state of rest or in a state of sleep and get up into a different posture. It's time to face the day. And when I think of your light has come, something brilliant, something radiant. When we, Sherman and I, years ago, right after we were married, we decided we're not going to spend a lot of money in renting. So we came across a deal where we could buy, now y'all listen, if you call me trailer trash, I'm going to say that's right after this is done. But Sherman and I, because I've heard those stories before. Anyway, Sherman and I bought a 14 by 60 mobile home trailer, okay? It was on a private lot. We bought that, and we lived in it. It had brown paneling in it, very few windows. And by the time it was time to move out of there, when we built our house, and I built my house myself, my father-in-law helped, Brother Earl, when he was part of this congregation, he helped me. It took me a year and 9 months to build my own home. And very nice to be able to build my own home and do all that. And JJ and Naomi have been doing some stuff in their house, and many of you have been doing some stuff in your house. But it was awesome to be able to build my own house. But one thing that I wanted in my house, I was so sick and tired of those dark walls and dark. It was so dark in that place. You wouldn't even know it was like daytime till almost midday. The way the trailer faced that brown siding, one window in the side of it. I mean, it was like, good night. It was so dark. And so when we were building our house, and before we started building our house, we were looking at plans. And I'm like, I want something with windows in this place. Oh my goodness, I didn't know I was setting up me or her or both of us up for window cleaning that is of the devil. I'm talking about, I got to climb out on dormers, bro. I got to get up on my house on a 9-12 pitch roof to get to the dormers of my house to be able to help do windows. And you know what? Every Christmas, she wants candles in those windows. I'm like, does she have plans with my insurance company to collect real? Anyway, but I wanted some light. Now in our house, brother, when it gets daytime, it's daytime. I don't care. You turn the blinds shut. There, each room has 3 to 4 windows in it. We have a breakfast nook that's got like 6 or 7 or 8 windows in it. I mean, it's beautiful. You can see outside. Freeze to death over there, but it's really nice. You can see outside. I wanted to be able to have windows because I was tired of the darkness. And I believe God is saying it's time to shine. When Jesus said to us as a people that we're supposed to let our light so shine, I believe that what he is saying to us is to be brilliant or be radiant or allow something to reflect something other than darkness, something other than sleep and slumber. I'm not against rest. That's not what the enemy is here. But it is a state of being that gives us permission to be effectiveless. Are you with me? And so we've been trying to get this out and say, Lord, what are you saying? So as I've already told you, I'm going to run through this list fast. I'm not going to give every description to everyone. First one was about the Word of God. The first message, the first of the year was about the Word of God. We gave you out soap notes and helped you to have a journal. Number two, we talked about prayer and fasting, and you prayed and fasted with us for 21 days. We talked about re-engaging in faith and how much faith is important because the Bible says without faith it's impossible to please God. Number four, we talked about maturity, that if we're ever going to be given the greater of the kingdom, even though a son is a son and has it all, he differs not from a slave, though he owns it all, until he comes to a place of maturity. Then the Father says, all that I have is yours. And we talked about how important it is for us as a people to mature. Number five, we talked about what works, what really works. Not coming up with some new doctrine, but that which does work, that which is always worked. The blood of Jesus Christ, the gospel of the kingdom, the power of the Holy Spirit, the things that do work. Remember, I told the story about changing the chicken recipe. That's one of my favorites. I heard that from a friend of mine. Is that sometimes what we try to do is change the recipe instead of cooking a fresh batch of what really was good, what really worked. And so we try to make it differently. Number six, the first thing has to be first. Remember, talk about putting the kingdom first. God really has to be first. Is God really first in your life? I had to preach that one online, but one of the most engaging online times that we've had was that message on that, or is God really first? People were telling me, I was so captivated by the Holy Spirit watching that on my computer, that and the tears that would begin to wail, and my heart would begin to be drawn into, God, have I really put you first? And there's a purpose behind it. It's called awakening. It's called a rising and shining. Last week, I talked about no retreat, no surrender. And the big thing from last week was the third monkey. I don't know why that one stuck so well, but it was the third monkey that was trying to get on the ark when it started to rain. That wasn't really the point of the message, but the point of the message was basically, don't retreat from the promises of God. Don't be like Elimelech and run away when you're supposed to be strong in the house of bread and the land of praise. Because even if there's dry seasons, God always revisits his people and always comes where there is a house built of praise. This week's message is unify as one. So let's go to this. I will admit to you today, and a lot of this series has to do with the church. If you're your first-time guest and you're not part of a church, we would love to see you be a part, man. I'm telling you, we'd love to see you be a part of what God is doing. But I will admit to you today, my message is primarily to Christians, and I want you to hear my heart as I begin to share what I feel like the Lord has placed on my heart. Isaiah chapter number 58, we're going to go 3 through 9. I've only got 2 points to today's message. I've only got two. That doesn't mean it's going to be shorter, but there is two. I always have to be funny about that. You always give me a hard time. Isaiah 58, 3 through 9. Here's what God is saying to the people. He says, why have you fasted? Then say, and you have not seen? Why have we afflicted our souls? You've not taken notice. In fact, in the day of your fast, you find pleasure and exploit all your labors. Indeed, you fast for strife and debate. So do you understand what's happening here? Here is a people crying out to God, why do we afflict our soul, fast, do all this stuff, and you're not doing anything? Why is it that we've done this stuff and you don't seem to be moving? Why is it that we've prayed 1,000 prayers and you still seem to be in heaven doing nothing? Why is it that we've called, we've fasted, we've afflicted ourselves, and you're not doing anything? And God begins to respond. He says, in the fact, what happens is that you're supposed to be fasting away from certain labors and seeking my face, and you basically just come up with a new diet. And he says, here's what's happening. He said, and exploit all your labors. He said, indeed, you fast for strife and debate. In other words, he says, the object of your fasting is not for my glory and not for my radiance, but it's for your divisive measures. And so he says, to make your voice heard on high, is it a fast that I have chosen? A day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head like a bulrush and to spread out sackcloth and ashes? Would you call this a fast? And an acceptable day of the Lord? Is this not the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, that you break every yoke. Come on, somebody, that sounds like awakening right there to me. That sounds like a move of God I'd like to be a part of. It says, is this not to share your bread with the hungry? Can you say amen? And that you bring to your house the poor and the outcast or the cast out? That are cast out, when you see the naked, that you cover him, and not to hide yourself from your own flesh, then your light shall break forth as the morning. Your healing will spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call on the Lord, and he will answer, and you shall cry, and he will say, here I am. If you take away the yoke from your midst, the pointing of the finger and speaking wickedness. May the Lord add blessing to his word. Again, here you find this situation where Isaiah is speaking and pinning down the conversation that basically is going on between the nation of Israel and its God. Our God, Yahweh, the Lord, who through that nation birthed Messiah, and Messiah Christ, Jesus, died for the sins of the entire world and gave us a way into the family of God through his shed blood and his cross, who promises victory through his resurrection. And this God has responded by saying, here's the problem. Yes, I did say that you're to fast. And yes, I did talk about the things that I have shared with you. But here's what you have done. You have made me now. You're leveraging against one another. So here's what I want to share with you. And please, please understand where my heart is in this. Did you know that every great move of God in times past came to pass through a remnant of people that participated with what the Lord wanted to do in the earth? God, when he sent tremendous moves of God, whether it was to the nation of Israel or other places in other nations, the Lord always done it through a remnant of people. Did you know this, though? That every hindrance and disruption that came against the move of God came through a remnant of people that participated with the devil to do what he wanted to do on the earth. In other words, they became co-conspirators with the enemy. Even when the enemy wanted to disrupt things all the way in the garden, what he began to do was whisper to someone. And then that person got another person. Eve went and got Adam in with her. And they, because guess what? It feels better when you got somebody with you. In other words, if you got somebody with you, it kind of relieves your own guilt, right? At least you can blame half of it on him. He made me do it. And they tried that, right? Remember, don't you remember in Genesis 3 when the Lord comes down and he visits with them? And what happens is you know, he starts with Eve or starts with Adam. He's like, dude, paraphrasing. Okay. God don't say dude, does he? He does to me. Might not you. But anyway, what are you doing, man? And he's like, Adam's like, that woman you gave me. Yeah. Like blaming it on God, like in a way. You know what I'm saying? It's that woman you gave me. So God judges Adam, and then he goes to Eve, like, what are you doing? Do that. And she's like, the devil made me do it. Right? She's blaming somebody. So it's always, it feels a little bit easier. Doesn't get you out of it, but it feels a little bit easier when you kind of blame it on somebody. So basically, that's the two points, is the move of God and the move of the enemy. Let's start with the move of God. The move of God. Oh, no. Let's see. Do I want to start there? No, I don't want to start there. Let's start with the move of the enemy. Let's start with the move of the devil. Are you ready? The move of the devil. The devil would get into, here's how he does. He gets into someone's ear. The enemy is, he's not looking to come and bite you with fangs or poke you with a pitchfork. Right? In fact, he's not even got you teetering on the banks of hell and looking to push you over. That's not how he does it. What he does is he's looking to speak to you in your ear. He's looking to affect your thinking because he knows a principle. A biblical principle is, as you think in your heart, so are you. He knows that God created you, that you're to guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flows the issues of life. That's why when Jesus comes into your life, he wants to make your heart different. Come on, somebody. And then he wants to change your thinking, right? Because what the enemy understands is that's how God created us. And that's how we respond to life. That's how we interact with one another. And so the enemy wants to come in and try to shift the thinking so that the thinking then begins to help pollute the heart. And those two become co-conspirators against the will and the plan of God. And so the enemy loves to come and offer some suggestions. Now listen to me. Those suggestions can be whole lies or half-truths. Whole lies or half-truths. And sometimes the whole lies are easy to detect, correct? Sometimes whole lies are easy to detect. But half-truths are harder to detect. Y'all heard me say the best liars know how to sow just enough truth into the story to make it convincing. And the enemy will try to sow a lie into the thinking. And then what happens is that once the enemy sows the lie into the thinking, can I really trust that individual? Did this individual say this? Did that say that? Is God really like this? Whatever the suggestion that the enemy sows in, we start contemplating it. Rather than pray about it, we start contemplating it. We start then depending on ourselves. We start investigating from a distance. Sometimes we don't go ask the person. Sometimes we don't go in and face it head on. We're just from a distance. From a distance. So in a church setting, it looks like this. The enemy says, all preachers are out for your money. Then they hear you take an offering, and then the enemy says, see, there he's just after your money. Right? We don't want to investigate the books. We don't want to say, hey, can I see the books of the church so that you can see it all? What we'd rather do is sit back and see that's it. That's it. That's what's happening right there. People are after my money. People are after this and people are after that, and I don't trust them. And I get it. I understand, because it's hard to trust. I get it. But the problem is because we don't handle things correctly, what we begin to do is conspire with the enemy. And what he's trying to do is steal, kill, and to destroy. He's trying to distract. He's trying to destroy our lives personally and our lives together corporately. And his main goal is not you. The devil don't love you that much. In fact, he don't love you at all. You're a tool to him. You're a tool. You're nothing more than a tool to the enemy. But to God, you're everything. You're worth it all to the Lord. You're worth everything to God. And God set out to prove that by giving his son. God said, Bible says, God commended his love toward us, and while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God's trying to help you to understand that I love you. I see you as a person. I created you. You have been fearfully and wonderfully made, but the enemy just sees you as a tool. And his tool is to steal, kill, and to destroy. And ultimately to steal the glory and the praises that belong to God. And so what the enemy does is he finds someone's ear that he could easily whisper into. Easily whisper into. Offer a suggestion. Offer an idea. Offer something to them, hoping they'll take the bait. John Bevere, several years ago, some of you know who John Bevere is, some of you may not. Very, very used of God, man of the Lord. Written several books, Christian books, that I think are phenomenal. I'm actually reading one of his right now. I've had the amazing privilege of doing a couple of book reviews for Messenger International. Not that I'm any great anybody. I don't even know why they chose me. I have no clue. Maybe they drove my name out of a hat. I have no idea. I don't even know how they got it, but I had that amazing privilege. And one of them I'm reading right now. I'll tell you about it in just a few minutes, just a little piece, because I'm just barely into it. In fact, I've just barely cracked the pages of it. I'm so captivated by what the Lord used in the first little bit of it based upon a scripture that he had me reading. Have you ever had those things that you're reading something in God's word, all of a sudden you run across this and God puts them together for you, just like, boom, oh, this is amazing, Lord. Anyway, John Bevere wrote a book several years ago called The Bait of Satan. The Bait of Satan is a book about how people get offended easily, how that happens. And he calls it Satan's bait. Now, somebody who loves to fish, my goal is to try to find a bait that the fish are biting. And I might get this great idea. I might hear this a little bit of buzz if I'm going to the bait shop. And they say the bass are hitting a drop shot rig. So, man, I go into buying what I can get for a drop shot rig. And I go to the lake, and I'm casting the drop shot. If I don't get a bite in a little while, you know what I do? I change the bait. Because my hope is I can find what they're eating. In the bait of Satan, I believe the enemy loves to change the bait to just try to find something that somebody will eat. Something that tastes good to them. Something that is flavorful. Something that will snare them and catch them so that his ultimate purpose is to steal the glory of God. And so the enemy looks for an ear, and here's what I know. As I've already stated, everybody wants somebody to make them feel good about themselves. Several years ago, I read a book on the spirit of Jezebel. Y'all know who Jezebel was in the Bible. In case you don't, she was a very wicked lady who, her father was a pagan and she worshiped false gods. But she married a king in Israel who was supposed to worship the one true living God. And because maybe of her smooth looks or her whatever, this guy begins to degrade and move away from God, and she actually subdues him to the point that she's calling all the shots now, and he's just kind of, yes, honey. He's just kind of bowing down and just kind of letting her have her way. And this lady is so degraded and so ungodly that she sets up some temple, builds other temples, and creates a worship that is so ungodly and so perverse. It has all kinds of perverted things that are going on in terms of that worship model and lifestyle. And what she later then does is become so perverse that she's mentioned even all the way in the book of Revelation. Not her specifically, but what is happening through her influences and the way she operated. And so you see this whole demonic thing with Jezebel. And Jezebel, when someone wrote a book about Jezebel, they wrote the book as what happens with the spirit of Jezebel is that she's the one that comes in, fine, and it's not necessarily gender specific, but because it was a female in the Bible, I'm going to use the gender of she. She comes in and finds that ear that she can talk to, but the first thing she does is make a little bit of the story appear around somebody who feels the same way. So Jezebel gains momentum by going to individuals that may harbor her own feelings about a situation. And the way to not be influenced by the spirit of Jezebel is shut her down. Don't give her any authority. Don't give that authority in your life. Don't let that lie begin to light in your heart. Don't conspire with someone else. So what she does is she finds some people. In fact, she calls them her prophets. But people who don't like the same things or don't care for the same things or are mad at the same things or offended at the same things. That's what the enemy does. That's how she works. And the next thing you know, that one lie that was among one now is propagated among a small group. Are you with me? Then that small group then begins to share it with everyone else. And even if somebody else doesn't take the bait at that point, the group's influences is at the point that the culture of the community then begins to be polluted. And that's how the enemy works. He creates division. He's pointing the finger. He's speaking to people like they're the only righteous one. And all of a sudden people become self-righteous. And instead of us then looking and recognizing that the enemy that we're fighting is the devil, people start fighting among themselves.
And then those who feel real self-righteous about it will start fasting. And what they're fasting for is not the kingdom come and the will be done, but God justify me somehow. Make me look right. Make me look better. You know they're a bunch of unholy heathens. You know this is happening. You know, and God's saying, listen, you're fasting, and your fast has to do with you. And I'm trying to save a hurting, broken, lost, dying world. And you become so self-indulged and self-seeking and self-righteous that he then says, you're fasting, but it's to no avail. He says this. He says, you're pointing the finger. You've made people the enemy. Instead of the demonic and the devil, you're now speaking wickedly of one another. Oh, those are not usually outright in front of everybody conversations. It's really only among that small group. Can you say amen? But the rest of us feel it. A small group gets a hold of that, and they begin to run with it. And until lives are destroyed, a move of God stops, a church is divided, families are torn apart, marriages, and ultimately affects a future generation. How many of you know somebody that whose kids grew up in an environment like that, a church environment like that, and they refuse to go back to church because they know that all church people are nasty and mean? That's what their thoughts are. That doesn't mean that they all are, but it means that the enemy got moving in such a way that people started fighting amongst themselves. Amen? And that's what the enemy does. That's the way that he works. He starts selling a lie. People start believing the lie or the half-truth, and then they begin to run with it. But let's look at a move of God. You ready for some good news? A move of God happens when someone's heart and ear begin to hear the whisper from the Holy Spirit. It all starts with the absolute truth, but it's a whisper from the Holy Spirit. God always starts somewhere. Somewhere where somebody can hear the voice of the Spirit. Where somebody is not looking to hear a lie from the enemy. Where somebody is not looking to put people down, but to exalt a God. Where people who are desiring to see the Lord do what their eyes haven't seen before. Or their ears heard, but they've read in the Bible how this kind of God can move. And so they begin to hear that. They hear the whisper of revival, outpouring, salvation, miracles, healing, unity, deliverance, favor, and blessing. And what they then begin to do is begin to share that with friends, like-minded friends, people who will burn for revival. You know who will receive it and who won't, but you're looking for those people because you know that God wants to use a people. God wants to use a group of people, and you begin to share that. And listen, there's nothing more powerful than a group of remnant people who will hear the voice of God, respond to what the Lord is saying, and then they get to be those people who get to tell the stories of blind eyes open, of deaf ears coming unstopped. They get to tell of what it was like to see the community prostitute get saved or the drug house closed down. They are the ones that get to see the power of God displayed and people get filled with the Holy Spirit. They are the ones that get to tell the stories of how the fire of God so fell and consumed a place that people were caught up in the presence of God, how the aroma of the entire atmosphere shifted as a result of God moving. So We are left with the fortunate decision. I'm glad that we can decide. Can you say amen? We can decide. Will we receive what God has? Will we hear the voice of awakening? Do we hear it beating down inside of our soul? And here's what I know. Anytime God is establishing something, wanting to do something, there's always a devil present. Can you say amen to that? And listen, even when God was sending Jesus, there's always a devil present. Judas Iscariot, one who gave his ear to the lies of the enemy and was in the midst of them. You understand that? But here's what I want you to know, but there's got to be the majority, there's got to be those people that hunger and thirst for the greater things of God. And you'll find that the Lord will respond to those that are hungry. Can you say amen? So here's what he does. The Bible says that God answers and says, here's the fast that I've chosen. I want to get you back to undoing heavy burdens off of other people. See, it gets them back to the original purpose with which he gave the nation of Israel to the world. It was to reveal the goodness and the glory and the holiness and the person of God. And now, through us, we have Jesus, who was the express image of the invisible God, who came and lived among us, dwelt among us, purchased us with his own blood, brought us into his family, and then says, you go be the light of the world, a city set up on the hill. And he says, through his great leadership after that, let there be no divisions among you. Where possible, endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. He said, where two or three of you gathered in my name, there I would be in the midst of them. He talked to us all about how important it was to guard the integrity of the unity of the body, because he says, when that happens, I'll be able to build a church that the gates of hell shall not be able to prevail against. So here's where we are. We're back in the place where Israel was then, and like we are right now. And God's saying, who will receive the word of the Lord that says, I have the fast that I've called and chosen for you is to undo heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, to heal the brokenhearted. And I say, yes, Lord, that's me. The enemy works so profusely in his devious ways through things such as unforgiveness, through harboring bitterness. I thought about that word, harboring bitterness. The word harbor. It's a maritime word. It's a place away from the rest of the ocean where boats come and load and offload. It's a place where they dock when a storm rages. And there's a sense where that sounds safe. But you don't get to walk on the water in the raging storms while docked at the harbor. You don't get to see God do the incredible docked at the harbor. Taking on a load of cargo of nothing more than trash. And so we can't harbor bitterness. He begins to work in divisions. He finds cliques. He finds where shaming is going on. But here's what the devil knows. The devil knows that according to the way the church works, that he knows that COVID's not going to stop it. Cancer's not going to stop it. This is going to offend some people, but government's not going to stop it. They've tried every time throughout history. Governments have tried. Government's not going to stop it. Demons don't stop it. Threats from hell itself doesn't stop the church. The only thing that's ever stopped the church from being effective is church people. So we look at people, but I want to give you an understanding. God has always used imperfect people to do incredible things. Look at me just a minute. If you want to find imperfections in your pastor, won't take long. Can I get a witness? I got the greatest witness that you could ever, 24/7, 365. This lady's with me. You want to see imperfections in one another, look long enough and you'll find them. Hello? We had this one little lady, used to go to church here. Some of y'all remember her. I've talked about her so many times. Her name's Miss Paul. Pauline Morris. Little Miss Pauline, 4 foot nothing, just amazing lady. Do you know what? I've watched that woman pray for people right in the middle of Walmart, wherever people get healed, receive miracles, all those sort of things. You know what? One time Miss Pauline got mad at me, and you know what she done? Punched me in the stomach. Punched me. You know what I did not do? Not only did I not touch her, I did not get mad at her. I was shocked. I couldn't believe it. You know what happened? A couple weeks after that, her family said, something's been happening to Pauline's mind. We're going to have to put her in
a nursing home. Imagine if I'd just got mad at Sister Pauline. It hurt. Now, she was 4 foot nothing, but them little bony knuckles felt like she touched my backbone right through there. Made me think of Smith Wigglesworth. Did she see a cancer in there and was knocking it out? I don't know, but no, she was mad at me. She was upset at me. I couldn't believe she'd done that. It shocked me so much, but I couldn't get mad at her. And when I found out the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey used to say, when I found out the rest of the story, it made me to understand, maybe she wasn't mad at me at all. Maybe it's just her mind going to a place that it didn't need to go. And they put her in a nursing home, and that's where she stayed until she went to be with Jesus. What are you saying to me, Pastor? I'm saying if you want a reason to get offended, there's, you know, close to 200 people in this room, look around. You'll find plenty of reasons as to why. We can find all kinds of things to disagree on. We can disagree on politics and start hating one another. We can disagree on race and start hating one another. Come on, somebody. We can disagree over all kinds of things and start being mean and ugly to people, but that's not what God's called us to do. And when we do that, what we'll start doing is partnering with the enemy. And I'm just telling you, what we need to do is unload our hearts of some things that the enemy has been using to destroy us. Jesus used some imperfect people. Just imagine trying to work with Peter. Just imagine trying to work with Thomas, and you're trying to do something great. You're trying to start a nationwide movement that will change the rest of the world, and you got to do it with a guy who won't even believe that you're who you are. Jesus continued to work with them. I'm just reminded. I'm doing a little. You guys know I'm engrossed in moves of God of the past. You've heard me tell about this gentleman before. How many of you have ever heard me tell the stories about a man by the name of William Daddy Seymour? Some, a few of you. If you went to Bible college, you heard about him. William Seymour is probably the most notable influence of the American Spirit-filled churches in history. William Seymour would have been the least likely. If you were to say, God, among one of the worst times in American history, right at the turn of the 20th century, about 1902-ish, 3-ish, right in that era, racism was as strong as it had ever been, though there had been an end to it, there wasn't an end to it, and still doesn't seem to be in many areas of life. Come on. But racism and smallpox. Did you know that this guy, and I'll tell you who he is in a second, William Seymour had smallpox. There was a pandemic during his days, during his time. He got smallpox, wound up scarring his face up pretty badly, and he lost vision in one of his eyes. He could not see in his eye. Some of the stories would be that his eye couldn't look where you were at. And so it looked a little bit, to some, very creepy. Unable to control his eye, he had a beating heart for the things of God. God had done a work in his life. He was born in Louisiana. In the South, among some of the worst racial tensions of the time. And he gets so enamored with Jesus Christ, the blood of Jesus, the forgiveness of sins, he gets called into ministry. He wants to go to Bible school, but since there were still laws of segregation, he could not be in the same classroom with the white guys, so they had to move him to a closet across the way, and him open the door, sit in one seat by himself, and listen as the Bible was taught. But instead of getting worse and offended and mad and taking the bait of Satan, he continued to grow in the knowledge of the Lord. He continued to walk with God. He continued to say, what humanity needs is the Lord. Some of his mentors that mentored him were strong people of the Spirit of God.
He wanted more of God. And then, if you've ever heard of the Azusa Street outpouring, yeah, now it begins to make sense. The Azusa Street outpouring that eventually happens in Los Angeles, California. Do you know the preacher that led that? Who God used? William Seymour. Who refused to be offended. Who refused to get his eyes on the wrong things. But kept them solely on God. Believing that God could change a country if that he would move. And I am telling you, the Church of God, the Assemblies of God, the Four Square Gospel, and just about every other spirit-filled movement in America can point its roots back to early 1900s at a meeting when people were there and the power of God fell upon people. People were, they were slain in the spirit by the hundreds. You know what some of the stories is? They would sweep the floors at the altar every night. You know what they were picking up at the altar every night? You know what they were sweeping? They were, you would think they're sweeping sawdust. They weren't sweeping sawdust. You would think maybe they're sweeping cigarette butts. Maybe people were getting delivered of cigarettes or whatever. You know what they were sweeping up almost every single night? Cancers that were falling off of people. Gorders that were falling off of people. And they tell stories of sweeping them up and hauling them out in trash cans by the miracles of the Lord that were happening. You say, preacher, you're foolish to believe such thing. Listen to me. If I believe this thing called the Bible, I can't help but to believe that this God, this amazing God who displayed his goodness through Jesus, where many miracles happened inside of this book, and where he said, these works that I do, that's going to happen for you and greater than these. He said that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I have to believe that that's the same God. And here's what I am trying to say to us. You have every opportunity every single week, as long as you're among people, to find a reason to get disunified and take the bait of Satan. But if God could find him a remnant that tuned their ears to only listen to the holy, to only listen to the godly, to long for the things of God, it's my personal belief that God still wants to do it again. I told you I was reading a book and I'm going to finish. I'm reading a book right now, and it's been out for a while, and I've heard snippets and all that sort of thing. So I got the book. It was a gift to me. And I began to read it. It was by John Bevere. It's called Kryptonite, like Unveiling Kryptonite or something like that. And it's in my thing right there. Could I tell you what's the exact title of that book, sweetie? Sorry about that. While she's unlocking that bag, he tells the story. When he does the introduction to the book, he said, now that I've done the introduction, please do not go over to the last chapter to try to get what's going on, because everything leads up. So I have done, what is it?
Killing kryptonite.
Y'all know kryptonite is kind of fake, right? But let me give you the premise behind it. Finish my story. He said, don't go over to the end of it to try to get what's happening, because everything builds up to this. But he begins by talking about the 1970s comic books that were so famous about a man named Superman. Did you know he was started by a couple of high school dudes? A couple of high school guys started writing this fictitious character, this superhuman character called Superman, who wound up making millions out of that. But I read a book also called Do Hard Things. It was about a couple of guys that were in their early 20s who started companies when they were in high school and were millionaires by the time they were 20s. Because in high school, when everybody else was thinking that life was about partying and sowing you your wild oats, two other individuals were sown into that they could do amazing things if that they could get the knowledge of God birthed inside of their heart and pray to believe God for great things, and they did outside of that. So these two guys wrote about this superhuman dude called Superman. How many of you have seen at least one Superman movie? A lot of us have. Superman, Clark Kent, right? So Superman He's this dude who's just a regular guy until the damsel in distress begins to call out. Somebody in trouble. And then he goes into the phone booth and his suit and tie is changed into underwear with a cape. I don't know what his thing's, his garb is called. Y'all may know. I don't know. But he's got this suit on with his cape and he's flying through the air. And he can leap tall buildings in a single bound. And he can lift. He's got enough power to stop a locomotive. I don't remember the whole thing that he used to be able to do, but he could do all of this. What? Faster than a speeding bullet. Yes, sir. And he did all his thing, you know. But after a while, I mean, like, people got bored by it. They got bored by it because, like, how many people can you rescue in different situations? And after all, the end of the story was always going to turn out that Superman defeated the enemy. So they wrote into the storyline a tale about this stuff called kryptonite. It was a radioactive element. But here's the caveat, and here's where this really hit home. In the midst of doing some reading and studying where this landed with me, here it is. Kryptonite was found only on the same planet that Superman came from. You say, well, big deal, right? The point of the message is today, not Superman. The point of the day is what is killing the church may be coming from the same planet. Do you know what happens? Some guys go get kryptonite. And you know what happens to Superman? If he gets around it, he becomes just like a normal human. And people are begging for us to be normal and natural. And God's called us to be supernatural. And what happens is, see, what God's put inside of us is eternity in our hearts. The power of the Holy Spirit, the very same Spirit, the Bible says, that raised Jesus Christ up from the dead, lives in you and gives life to your mortal bodies. You, I know you look like a human, but there's something super about you. It's not superhuman, it's supernatural. It's super from an almighty God who has given you the message of eternity, who has placed all things that you need that pertains to life and godliness in your life, who says, I'll be with you and I'll never forsake you, who says, I'll go with you to the ends of the earth, who says, you can lay hands on the sick and see them recover, who says that you declare a thing and it shall be established, and God says, I will put this in you. But you know what? Kryptonite makes you nothing more than a human. You know what that looks like? Can we have altar lights? You know what that looks like in an altar call? These are natural hands. Might stink a little bit. I've been rubbing my mouth, so don't touch them. Natural hands. I am a human being. You look at me long enough, you'll see my faults and failures. I'll come short. I am. That's no doubt about that. No doubt about it. But when Holy Spirit is supposed to come and indwell, what happens to normal things is supernatural operation begins to happen. Now, don't look at me. We could use any of you. Any of you. Come here, Isaac. Join me up here. Y'all see ponytail, red beard. Okay? But he's a child of God. And the problem is that if I need brokenness taken out of my life, if I need healing, if I need set free, if I need somebody to believe for me, then I can't walk up here thinking, well, here's old Redbeard. Touch me if you can. What I've got to believe is that, see, because what I'm doing when I do that is I'm just taking a bunch of kryptonite with me. Bless me if you can. And you're sitting there holding kryptonite, and what I feel right now is just his hand touching me. But if I'll remove kryptonite and I'll put my faith and my confidence in God, and I'll recognize that Lord, the Lord uses Peter, And he used James, and he used John, and he used Seymour, and he used others. Listen to me. There were some things about Seymour's life that people questioned, and you know what they done? They locked the doors on him the first place he ever went to preach, but they locked the door on revival. They locked the door on awakening. They locked the door that's marked as one of the greatest moves of God in our history, happened in the turn of the century, because they did not want this weird-looking, one-eyed black man to touch them, because they were so segregated. The white people didn't think that somebody of his stature, of his caliber, could lay hands on them and nothing happened. Touch me if you can, because I'm better than you, because I'm white. Listen to me. I am telling you, to hell with such division, to hell with such foolishness, and let's let God be God. If God wants to use a white man, a black man, a yellow man, I could care less. If he wants to use a woman, listen, if he wants to use a woman, I could care less. Just God, move among us and let us understand that there is something supernatural in the family of God. And here's the big thing. Somebody's got to be brave enough to take the kryptonite out of here. It doesn't belong in this planet. Thank you. It doesn't belong in the planet. Because if it does, what happens is Superman becomes a normal human. Now listen to me. I want to be careful here, because the church has been guilty by making superheroes out of people. That's not the point of this message. The point of this message is not to make superheroes out of any human being. It's to understand that a supernatural God dwells in normal people. And if we will recognize that a normal or supernatural God dwells in normal people, you'll get a miracle from the Lord if you don't take kryptonite with you. One last story. I may have told you this story. I don't know if I have. Indulge me just for a minute, and then I'll close this thing out. President of Oral Roberts University. He was put in after Hobby Lobby kind of helped them get out of a financial situation, Dr. Mark Rutland. I've been in services with Dr. Mark Rutland, fascinating human being. Been in small groups with him, fascinating man. He tells a story that he was invited to preach somewhere at a conference, and he had had a bone spur on his foot. And he said after doing some of that, he said, my foot was hurting me so bad, I literally thought I would cry the pain of that foot. And he said, I'd a few days into that, and he said, I was ready to cancel, but I felt like I couldn't do that. So he went on to the church early one night, and that evening, and some of the ladies that was helping get maybe first impressions or something going or helping was there. And one of the ladies had a son who suffered from a mental illness. And he was in his maybe late 20s, potentially early 30s. But he was running through the auditorium with two little cap guns on his side and like a cowboy belt on, little cowboy hat, had a vest on. Mark said he had a star like a sheriff, and he was running up to everybody, bang, and then put his little gun up and go on. But he was old, you know, older. He wasn't a little kid, but mentally he was like a little kid. Mark tells a story that he was in the auditorium that night, and it was getting closer to service, and people were kind of coming in. And he said he was literally laying up near the front on a pew saying, oh, God, please help me. I don't know how I'm going to do this. And that guy was running through the auditorium, made his way up to where Mark was. Mark stopped him, and he said, I can't remember the guy's name. John, we'll say. Any John's in the room, we'll pick on you. And maybe he stopped him and said, listen, John, will you, Brother Mark is in pain. Will you pray for me? He said, my foot is hurting me. He said, that young man took his cowboy hat off and got down in front of him and took his foot and said, D-dut. I'm not making fun here, but this is Mark saying this story. I'm repeating him. D-dut. Would you please touch Mark's foot? In Jesus' name, amen. Bang, bang, Brother Mark.
Mark said that scared the living daylights out of him. He said, I lost it in that. He said, but I'm telling you right now, the power of God touched my foot and I was healed. Because I asked one thing, I recognized, God, even this young man who barely knows maybe who you are, Jesus died for him, and I believe you can use him. And God touched him. Now, if that's not a true story, that's on Mark Rutland, and y'all can look him up. Oh, you need to watch a message by him on YouTube called Power, Not Power. Phenomenal. Power, not power. Beautiful. Anyway, the point of the story is here. We're not trying to make celebrities out of anybody other than Jesus Christ. And the Lord said, as we begin this, okay, God, we want to walk in awakening. And the Lord says, okay, here's how you do it. Put my word first. Pray and seek my face. Let faith arise in you. Mature in the things of God. Put my kingdom first. Do not back up and don't retreat. And above all else, get rid of the kryptonite so that my people that have been under my calling can operate in my anointing that breaks every yoke. So maybe to this morning, maybe there's something in there. Maybe you're in the harbor, and what's been loaded in the harbor is the brokenness, the bitterness, whatever that the enemy's tried to load you down with, that becomes the kryptonite that stops breakthrough for you.